Emotivism is a moral theory. What does it actually say? Before worrying about whether it's right or wrong, whether it applies to all cases or just some cases, what is it actually saying? What did you get from the reading? MacIntyre sort of gave a few kind of definitions at a couple points. If you were on the spot and you had to explain it to somebody else who wasn't in this class, what would you say? I'll get you started. It's a moral theory that does what? It's based on the person's emotions. That's a good start. In what way? Yeah.
It expresses your preference to things.
What expresses your preference?
Your judgments.
Yeah, okay. So with emotivism, when you're making moral judgments or using moral language, well, he uses moral terms like good, bad, right, wrong, should, shouldn't, that sort of stuff. What are you really doing? You are really just expressing, as he puts it, feelings, attitudes. I would extend it to include desires, maybe an expression of your own self-interest. Let me read you one or two things that people who actually were emotivists said about this sort of thing. MacIntyre's not off, but sometimes it's nice to hear it in people's own words. So this is A.J. Ayer. He was a famous philosopher. He was associated with what's called logical positivism, but I don't know what that'll mean that much to you. He says, here's my view. In saying that a certain type of action is right or wrong, I'm not making any factual statement. Not even a statement about my own state of mind. I'm not saying that this is how I think about it. What I am doing is expressing certain moral sentiments. And of the man who's ostensibly contradicting me, who's taking a different position, is merely expressing his moral sentiments. He says there's plainly no sense in asking which of us is in the right. Neither of us is asserting a genuine proposition. Neither of us is actually saying something meaningful. We're just expressing how we feel about things. So if I look at somebody doing an action, I say that person is bad, or that person is disgusting, or that's a horrible thing to do. And you say, I think they ought to do it. I think that's a great thing that they're doing it. Ayer would say, well, neither one of us is right, neither one of us is wrong. We're just expressing how we feel about it. And then he says, in every case in which one would commonly be said to making an ethical judgment, the function of the relevant ethical word, so not all the stuff, but just the ethical terms, is purely emotive. It's used to express feeling about certain objects, but not to make any assertion about them. He says it's worth mentioning also that ethical terms don't serve only to express feelings. They also have another purpose, which is to arouse feeling in other people, right? And thereby to motivate them to action. So if I see you doing something, what's a typical thing that professors get on students about?
Cell phone.
Oh, perfect, yeah. Okay, so you're on your cell phone, and I say, you really shouldn't do that. And what am I doing? I'm expressing my disapproval. And I'm trying to get you to feel that you really ought not to do that. I'm trying to get you to feel bad in some way. I'm trying to have you reflect on your own thing. I'm trying to get you to feel in such a way that if the person next to you also gets on their cell phone, you don't like that, right? You don't see them as now akin to you. You're more like me, and you say, that's a bad thing. Meaning, I don't like that. And that'll get you to act differently, right? And I could do it in a lot of different ways. I could blow up at you, get that cell phone off, right? I mean, that would be one way to do it. That might produce more emotion quickly in you. Or I might be, you know, I'm very sweet. You know, we're not supposed to have cell phones in this classroom. We have this kind of implicit contract here. Yeah, it might be something like that. But if air is right, all we're doing, it's the same thing. We're really just trying to express a certain disapproval and get you to feel that disapproval yourself and get you to change your behavior. What's something that students want professors to do that they typically don't do that they should do? Not like give everybody A's or something like that, but something that professors fall down on the job sometimes of doing. There's got to be stuff that you guys would like to see, yeah.
Getting work back on time.
Oh, that's a big one. Work with good feedback delivered, you know, say within a week, right? Is a week a good amount of time? Even that's kind of pushing it for some things. Okay, so you say to me then something like, you really ought to get your, we're handing in the work on time ourselves, you really ought to get the work done on your part on time. You know, you should be held to the same standards as us. What you're doing there is you're expressing a kind of positive attitude. And or, you know, if you say, Dr. Sadler's a good professor so far because he actually, you know, graded our stuff within the first week. We'll see how that goes the rest of the semester, right? You're expressing approval of me or my actions. And then I can feel, you know, warm and fuzzy inside. You guys, I don't know if they had this when you guys were kids, cold and pricklies and warm and fuzzies. It was like a kindergarten thing when I was a kid. You know, probably they change all these things. But that's what the emotivist theory is saying our moral language basically is. We're expressing how we feel, what our attitudes are, whether we approve or disapprove of things. And when we disagree about it, there's nothing to be done other than try to maybe bring pressure to bear on somebody. You can't actually rationally argue them into it, because if you could, they'd already hold that position.
So is no one right and no one wrong?
It's interesting to ask that. In a certain way, yes. No, nobody would be right, nobody would be wrong. We all just have our own views. Now, like some emotivists have pointed out, that doesn't prevent us from feeling that other people are wrong. One of the guys who I'm putting a link to in the supplemental stuff for you, but I'm not suggesting you have to read for this class. He was pointing out that, you know, if we're emotivists, that doesn't mean that we have to say Hitler's a-okay. We can feel that what he's doing is definitely wrong. We can, you know, watch footage of the concentration camps and say, this is horrible. But all we're actually doing is expressing our feelings. We're not actually right in the sense that it conforms to any sort of objective moral order. And, of course, you know, Hitler apparently didn't think that what he was doing was wrong, because most of those other people that were lined up with him, they thought that that was the good thing to do. But all they were doing, you know, on their part, was expressing their feelings. They were doing a lot more than expressing them, weren't they? Actions are significant. So in that sense, yeah, nobody's right, nobody's wrong. We all have a sense that we're right and the other person's wrong. Now, that's not the whole story, though, because emotivists, like MacIntyre points out, if you really buy into this theory, then you probably think that people should quit all this moralizing. And if you say that, you're actually saying that other people are wrong, aren't they? That we should abandon all this, you know, highbrow moral theory stuff. And if you don't abandon it, if you're like, you know, somebody like me who likes Aristotle, then I'm wrong in a certain way from the modalist perspective. So there's two answers to that, really. But it's an important question. This other guy, Stevenson, he's a particularly important emotivist thinker. He wrote at the end of one of his essays, ethical statements are social instruments. They are used in a cooperative enterprise in which we are mutually adjusting ourselves to the interests of others. So there are ways in which we try to make people feel the way that we want them to feel and do the things that we want them to do. And everybody else is doing the same thing to us. So when your mom disapproved of something that you were doing or didn't like one of your friends and said they're a bad person or you're doing the wrong thing, all she was doing was expressing her feelings, but she was trying to get you to feel likewise. When you responded in kind, I suppose, and said, no, they're a great person. You were just expressing your feelings and trying to get your mom to see things your way. Yeah.
So a motivist are saying that no one's really telling you what to or to not do, but they're just saying how they feel, hoping to change your view.
It's not quite so, so innocent as that. They think that we're constantly exerting a kind of pressure on each other to change the way that we see things. And our society does that too, they think too. You know, if we're emotivists and I want you to stop doing the action that you're doing and I really hate what you're doing, feel really strongly about it, I don't know that we could say that I'm just trying to offer you another way or suggest that you should go a different way or something like that. I'm really trying to force you into it in some cases.
But then in that case, they're saying that there is a right and wrong.
No, again, the emotivist thinks there's only right and wrong from the perspective of, you know, how I see it or how you see it. There is no, like, universal right and wrong. This is one of the problems with the theory. So you're kind of leading us ahead to some of the criticisms of the theory. So emotivism is, like MacIntyre says, it's the doctrine all evaluative judgments, and specifically moral judgments, are nothing more than expressions of preference, attitude, or feeling, insofar as they're expressive of those things in character. So what are the implications of this? I put some of this in Eiler for you. Moral claims aren't true and false. They're indexed to the individual person. Even more importantly, if emotivism actually is right, then there's no rational way to decide disagreements. So when it comes to big issues, the moral things that we, say, get involved in politics about, or activism, we just feel different ways about it. We may produce theories, and we may make arguments, but that's just sort of window dressing from an emotivist perspective. It's not really what's going on. Those are words being used kind of as tools. Now, one of the things that I want to point out with this, so MacIntyre says that if somebody's saying from an emotivist perspective, X is good, what they're saying is something like, I like X, you should like it too. Or hooray X, or I approve of X, or I have a positive feeling or attitude towards X. And you can ask why a person has this positive feeling, right? Let's say we take something that I'm willing to bet most of you like, candy, right? You still like candy? I like candy. Why do you like candy? Think about your favorite candy, whatever it happens to be. And then after that, we can argue about which is the best candy, right? We can get all emotivist about it. No, this is the best, right? But why do you like your candy the best? Yeah.
I mean, candy's sweet. It gives you, like, pleasure, right?
That's it right there. It gives you pleasure through its sweetness, and you've experienced it so many times in your life. And I'm willing to bet that you also psychologically associate candy with some other things, like being rewarded. Yes? If you're good, then you get some candy. Now, after a while, you start to associate with it. It could be in school, could be, you know, you go to the store and you're not acting like a jerk, you know, with your parents because they want to shop and they buy you a candy bar afterwards. Or you keep your mouth shut about something and your reward is a candy bar. Or, how else do we get rewards of candy?
You do your chores.
Halloween.
Oh, you do your chores. Hey, I was thinking about Halloween, and Halloween is a little bit different because I guess you're being rewarded for putting on a costume and going to the door. It's almost like a social ritual, right? And Halloween and Easter is the time when you luck out on candy. Easter is even easier. You just put your basket there, and somehow it winds up full of candy. Christmas, maybe the stockings. In my house, we had St. Patrick's Day because my mom had an Irish friend who the leprechauns would come, you know, on St. Patrick's Day, and they would turn the milk green and the toilet water green and stuff like that, and make streamers. And the best part was they would leave green-colored candy. There's not a lot of green-colored candy, unfortunately. It's all mint stuff, but if you like mint, that's a good time of year. You're not being rewarded in that case. You're just like lucky. But now, this whole story, right? You associate candy not just with the sweetness that you've experienced many times. You also associate it with, you know, kind of warm, fuzzy, positive feelings about good times and rewards and, you know, or at least not getting punished or something like that, right? Now, that's an answer about why you like candy, why you have a positive attitude towards candy. What about cheating on assignments? Do you have a negative attitude towards that? You think it's bad? How many of you think that cheating on assignments is bad? How many of you think it's good? Nobody? Do you do?
No, it depends on, like, good in what sense. Like, good, it's not good for your understanding, but it's good if you want to, like, if you have a bad time, like, trying to get ahead or trying
like
to...
Like, as an expedient to get through.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, there's an argument that could be made there, right? So those of you that feel that it's good, or those of you that feel that it's bad, sorry, those of you who feel that cheating is bad, do you think you could tell some sort of story about why you came to think that cheating is bad? Yeah.
My cousin and her, like, high school sweetheart got married, and
this isn't going to be about, like, cheating
pregnant
on spouses, is it?
Huh?
This isn't going to be about cheating on spouses,
yeah,
is it? Oh, boy. Okay.
Yeah. And yeah, everybody tune in. she got married to her high school sweetheart, and while she was pregnant with their second kid, it was discovered that he was having an affair with someone that he worked with. Now, the real twist comes in, not... Obviously, cheating's not good, in my moral opinion, but
yeah.
The real twist comes in is that the doctor that we thought he was having an affair with, she was a woman, ended up just being a cover for the fact that he was having an affair with another guy. So, like, she literally, I think she was like 8.5 months pregnant, like,
yeah,
all just starting to, like, go down, and she delivered the baby, he came into the hospital for like an hour, and my aunt, her mother, went up to him and told him to leave if he knew what was good for him. Because I come from, like, an Italian family, and you are gonna get your ass beat for something like that.
Yeah.
So I mean, ever since then, that's kind of really opened up my eyes to, like, cheating in terms of, like, is it
why it's bad, or as being
or
something bad, or why it's bad, or yeah, okay, that makes sense. I mean, you could probably come up with all sorts of reasons. Now, here's the thing: so you can come up with a story about why people have the particular feelings they do, right? If you're an emotivist, it doesn't make sense to ask, should they feel the way they do? Do they have good reason to feel that way? If you're an emotivist, you sort of take that out of the toolbox. Or ought they feel that way? Why is that? Well, anytime you're bringing in these moral terms, you've got the same problem again, don't you? If you say that, well, let's take some sort of thing that we probably can all agree shouldn't have good feelings about. Like,
heroin.
What's that?
Heroin.
Yeah, okay, that's a good one. I mean, heroin addicts would probably disagree
with
me. Yeah,
I was just gonna...
But, you know, I think we can have a consensus that you shouldn't shoot up heroin, right? As a matter of fact, let's even broaden that. Don't shoot up heroin. Don't smoke crack. The other big one. Don't smoke meth. You know. Don't use it in any form. There's other ways it can be used, of course. Those are the big three. That, you know, at least in our country right now.
Did you say coke?
No, because there's not many people doing coke because there's crack and heroin. But we can add it in. And we can also say don't do PCP because that's bad for you too.
It's not that bad.
PCP. Okay, so we say you shouldn't do these sorts of things. Now, from an emotivist perspective, all we're doing is expressing our disapproval, right? And the other person who says, "But I like crack. It's really nice," you know, or somebody else who's like a contrarian says, "Well, I think people should be able to do whatever they want, even if it's crack," right? They're just expressing their feelings as well. And if the emotivists are right, there's no rational way to decide between this. And you can't even say about the person who, say, likes crack. You can't say, "Well, that's a mistaken point of view that you've got there. You shouldn't feel that way. There's something wrong with you." Because again, what are you doing? You're just expressing your feelings. You're not actually expressing anything that has any real content, just feelings. This is kind of a good place to make a break. So if we start where MacIntyre starts in chapter 2, talks about moral disagreements in our society. This part of the text, at least, should have been fairly easy, right? He talks about, some sort of basic examples. Well, let's actually look at these. We won't go into any great detail. So the first one is about war. This is a contemporary issue, right? And he puts forth three different positions. Are these recognizable to you as things that people actually say that you hear today? So it's, even though this book was written in 81, the basic terms haven't changed that much. So a just war is one in which the good to be achieved outweighs the evils in waging the war, in which a clear distinction can be made between combatants and innocent non-combatants. Okay, so that's a moral claim, right? Is the war in Afghanistan or the war in Iraq, which now appears to be, at least as far as we're concerned, mostly over but really isn't over, is that a just war and an unjust war? You have a criteria there, right? Somebody says, "Here's what a just war counts as." And people argue about this. Think back to your middle school. Were people getting worked up about the Iraq war and whether it's a just war or not? They got worked up about a lot of other things. It's about oil, the new democracy doctrine, all this kind of stuff. But where do they go from this? Well, in a modern war, you can't calculate these things, and so we should all be pacifists. That's a moral claim too, right? Shouldn't engage in any wars. If you wish for peace, prepare for war. The only way to achieve peace is to deter potential aggressors. Therefore, you have to build up your armaments and make it clear that going to war on any particular scale is not ruled out by your policies. If you don't do that sort of thing, then you won't avoid war. People talk like this, don't they? Have you heard people saying that probably just as much as the other thing, the worries about whether the war is just? Some people say, "Yeah, I'm really not that worried about whether the war is just. It's us versus them." And if we don't, think about the war on terror. What do they say? If we don't defeat them over there, then what's going to happen? They're going to come here. So do you want to fight over there or fight here? You got to fight either way. That's another position, isn't it? That's not the same as that first position. The third one, wars between the great powers are purely destructive. What would be the great powers? Us and maybe China, Russia. But wars waged to liberate oppressed groups are a necessary and therefore justified means for destroying the exploitive domination which stands between mankind and happiness. Are there people who talk like this? War is usually bad, but if it's for some sort of oppressed group, then it's okay. Forget about wars. Think about violence in general. Generally, we shouldn't be violent towards each other, but if you've been kept down by whoever, some dominant class, your society, then it's okay to say riot or attack people or say engage in warlike activity. People say that sort of stuff, right?
That was the whole position during the 60s.
Yeah, you're right. And you can, that's actually a good point. You can look around societies and you can not only find these positions kind of free-floating out there, you can actually look around and say, hey, that person over there says this. This group over here expresses this point of view.
Well, there, even within subgroups you have those different moral theories that, you know, break.
That's why you can have debates within a group, like should we do this or should we do that?
Black Panthers or some of those other militant groups. You know?
Yeah, the Black Panthers would be a good example of that sort of thing. Although they seem to have like settled on a consensus eventually, right?
Yeah. But even the early civil rights movement has different consensus as far as nonviolence and violence and what you should do, what you shouldn't do, and when it was all right to defend yourself and when it wasn't.
Yeah, that's another good example. MacIntyre doesn't use that, but that would be a case where you had several different moral positions being put forward. So Martin Luther King's position is very different than Malcolm X's position. And they didn't, it's not as if these guys didn't talk to each other and try to convince each other. Martin Luther King actually wrote a whole book, which hardly anybody read, Where Do We Go From Here? Where he's actually talking about the Black Power movement, and he's condemning it. And you can see some other examples here. He talks about abortion, one of the most divisive issues of our time. Justice and opportunity. I came up with some suggestions about contemporary stuff that you see people talking about right now. Think about the you built it or you didn't build it discussion that's going on right now. That's a moral discussion. That's saying something about what people owe to each other. And, you know, I'm not going to worry about, you know, whether anyone was taken out of context, because actually both sides are taking each other out of context, but that's the way a lot of argument goes in our culture, isn't it? What would be some other examples? The Chick-fil-A issue, remember that, you know, a little while back. What was that about? Whether their sandwiches are tasty? What was it about?
Well, I feel like they didn't support gay marriage
or something. Yeah, you could put it different ways. They didn't support gay marriage. If you put it like that, it almost sounds like the default position is to support gay marriage. They were being accused by opponents of being hateful because they not only do they not espouse gay marriage, they espouse like a whole sort of comprehensive idea about what a Christian way of life would be, right? Now, are all Christians against gay marriage? No, you can find some churches coming out in favor of it, some against it, and people articulating different positions. Gay marriage, the reason why I brought up Chick-fil-A is gay marriage is one of those issues on which you could find yourself not just in the for camp or against camp, but you could find yourself in the for camp for different reasons, or in the against camp for different reasons. Right? And maybe there's even middle positions. What else? Think about the food choice issues that keep coming up. And what's the big worry that people have about kids and their cafeterias these days?
Soda.
What's that?
Soda.
Soda is a minor thing, although in New York, of course, that's become a big issue, right? And it could sort of stand for the whole thing. Yeah, what were you going to say?
I don't have like a choice, really. It's kind of just like French fries, soda.
Yeah, and even, you know, it's interesting. If you watch that Jamie Oliver show, he spends a lot of time trying to convince people not to eat French fries, doesn't he? And they'll offer like healthy food choices, and a lot of the kids will say, I kind of like the French fries, you know? So just putting the healthy food choices out there is not enough to actually get people to do it. Somebody had their hand up over here. Yeah.
I was just saying, in general, like obesity.
Yeah, obesity, and there's worries about, obesity wouldn't be that bad of a thing if it was just, didn't have any effects, right? We just all get fat, and then we carry around some extra weight. But it leads to all sorts of other things, right? Like medical issues, and then somebody's got to pay for those, and you know, it keeps you from doing things that you'd like to do. We kind of joke about this, but you know, trying to fit into some of these chairs in the classroom, right? I have a harder time fitting into those because I ate too much.
On an airplane?
Yeah, airplanes are not fun for me at all. There's no such thing as enough leg room if you're this tall. But the seats are even kind of small too. It's worse when you get three guys my size all piled into one aisle. Well, to go back to the food issue though, have any of you ever watched that Jamie Oliver show? It's interesting to watch in part because the people involved on both sides, or maybe on all sides, they start out nice, and then what happens after a while in these kind of shows? When they don't get their way, when the other person doesn't see it their way.
Aggravated.
They get aggravated. And that's an expression of emotion, right? Why do we get aggravated? Because that other person is too stupid to see what we're saying to them. They can't see their true interests, or they're not being convinced by our argument. And there's, reason why they ought to be convinced, because we're right. Maybe we are right, but that's something different from that aggravation. They go from nice to nasty pretty quick. Think about how many of you watch political shows or any sort of TV show where they've got the talking heads, they'll have like the commentator, and then they split the screen, and you've got somebody from the right, and somebody from the left, and then somebody from way out somewhere else, or maybe a moderating point of view. And they start out talking about an issue. What happens? They make arguments, don't they? They make moral claims. They say, here's why I think this. And so everything's going pretty good at that point. And then what happens? Yeah.
They all start over-talking each other, and no one's really listening to what the other person's saying.
Yeah. Or they're listening, but they're only listening to find that, yeah, what they want. They want to find that one point where they can concentrate and say, I got you now. So you're a bad person. I'm a good person. And that's kind of unfortunate, right? Because do you convince anybody of the rightness of your position, that you actually have a rationally defensible position when you resort to that? Or if you just start shouting, try to talk over the other people. You might convince people who think that, yeah, you must be right because you're louder. But that's not rational conviction. Go ahead.
It also depends on who's watching and where the venue is. I've watched a lot of political debates, and depending on where they're at, they can definitely have a sway.
Once
watched one at NYU at Harper Union.
Yeah.
And it was a room full of...
What was it about now?
It was something to do with finance. I can't really remember, but it was
okay.
A bunch of... It was two conservatives in this panel. And then obviously down in that
NYU is pretty liberal.
Yeah, very liberal school. So everything, so it was very one-sided type of argument.
Yeah, and that is, MacIntyre thinks, that is characteristic of our culture. Now think about personal arguments that you've gotten into with people. Maybe some of you don't like to argue with people. Maybe some of you actually like to argue too much. You may fit into a continuum, right? And where have you actually gotten into arguments with people where you have tried to convince them that something was the right thing or the wrong thing, and they had a different position, and they tried to convince you? Where does that happen? Laundry room? Probably not, right? If it does, man, you like to argue. Where does that happen to you? Mostly in classes? Does it happen to you much in classes? Probably not, right? Where does it happen to you? Because it does happen to you, doesn't it? Who did you first start arguing with when you got here to Marist? I bet I know.
Housemates.
Yeah, exactly. Your roommate or housemates, right? Why did you start arguing with them? Because you didn't see eye to eye on certain things. What do we argue about? Do we argue about things that are just facts usually? Not that much, because we can go check them. That's what we have Wikipedia for, right? Provided the entry's correct. What do we argue about? Plato says early on, we argue about the good and the bad, the just and the unjust, and the shameful and the honorable, these sort of moral values. And we give reasons why we think something is the good thing or the right thing to do or the wrong thing to do or the bad thing to do. Now, the thing that MacIntyre is pointing out with this is not that we just have different positions. That's been like that throughout all of history. Next week, when we look at Plato, we're going to see people putting forth radically different positions about what's right and wrong. What's different in our culture is that quite often these things boil down to shouting matches, mere assertion. I'm right, no, I'm right. Why does that happen? What happens when you get into arguments? Forget MacIntyre for a minute. What happens when you get into arguments and it turns into that? Why did it turn into that? Yeah,
I think fundamentally what ends up happening is it stops being an argument about moral right and moral wrong, but it turns into a power struggle. Who has the power?
Okay, it turns into a power struggle. And MacIntyre talks about that as like one will trying to dominate another will. And what are you trying to do in that case? You're trying to make your preferences or your feelings the one that rules. Trying to get somebody else not just to think the way that you do, but to feel the way that you do about moral things. So if you think that abortion is a terrible evil, and you talk about it, and you get into a debate with somebody who's pro-choice, sooner or later, if you have a kind of emotivist point of view, you're going to resort to just saying, it's wrong. It's just wrong, and that's all there is to it. And you'll say it louder and louder and louder. And the other person will just say, it's my right, it's my right, it's my right. And they'll say it louder and louder and louder. Now, that's very different than trying to rationally convince the other person, trying to produce arguments. MacIntyre says that that's a sign of emotivism in our culture. So let's look at this difference now between what he calls impersonal criteria and self-assertion. When you want to actually make a case to somebody, let's say you're writing a paper. That's probably the paradigm case for you. You have a professor and they say, you didn't actually make your case. How many of you have had this happen in English papers, right? When you're doing your writing classes, and you said something that you believe in, and you may have even given some reasons for it, right? And they found those reasons insufficient. What would you do at that point? If you don't want to just, if they're being a nice professor and not just saying, F, here you go, but they're actually like letting you revise the paper, what would you do? Yeah.
Probably go to their office hours and have them go through with you and see what you did wrong.
Okay, but now you're at the point where you actually know what you did wrong because they wrote on there, you didn't support your argument.
And I would just fix it.
How? What would that mean?
Like take their comments and then do exactly what they said.
Well, it's kind of open-ended though, isn't it? And this mm-hmm. is actually kind of the problem with a lot of writing classes, isn't it? They give you open-ended, I'd just like to see you doing more with this. Any of you had that sort of feedback? Yeah, somebody had their hand up over here.
I was going to say, like, go find, like, reputable sources that back up the points you're saying.
Okay. Yeah, you could go and try to find sources for the facts in what you're saying, or you could try to find other people who seem reasonable who agree with the values in what you're saying. You're going to say something.
No, I was going to say something similar to her. Just, okay. You know, just look for stuff that will support your argument. And then build an argument around that support.
Yeah, generally the way you support an argument is producing a little bit more argument. And you do this by trying to look for what the other person might find convincing. So you say, okay, you didn't buy this argument. I need to find some common ground for us where we share something, some premises that we can argue from, that we agree on. And then I'll get you to see things my way. Now, MacIntyre talks about this in a very nice way. He says, this is the kind of appeal to a type of consideration which is independent of the relationship between speaker and hearer. So it doesn't, if we're engaged in that kind of thing, it doesn't have anything to do with me as me. It doesn't have anything to do with you as you. And it could be about personal things, like you could be arguing with your parents about whether you ought to be allowed to drive the car when you're on break, you know, which maybe they don't want to let you do, because you know it's a nice car and they'd rather you drive whatever beater you've got. It could be about you, But you can do it in an impersonal way, can't you? You can make reference to general principles that aren't just about the relationship between the two of you or about who you are. You can even talk about your character. I'm trustworthy, Mom and Dad. But you would do it in such a way as to say things like, you know, trustworthy people, you should actually trust them with things. That's what it means for them to be trustworthy. And then just say, I just happen to be one of those kind of people. Do you see the difference between that and saying, I'm just right and you ought to see things my way? There's a real difference there. So he talks about the existence, independently of the preferences or attitudes of the speaker, and here, of standards, some sort of criteria, some sort of standards. And that's what we start out with. But if MacIntyre is right about contemporary discussions, that's what we quickly start veering away from. And we end up focusing much more on our own preferences, our own attitudes, the attitudes of the other person. We interpret them as saying what they're saying, not because there could be anything real to what they're saying, but just because they happen to feel that way, or it would suit them, or they have some sort of unreasoned, irrational, you know, weird thing coming from their background, or things like that. So again, let's think about that Chick-fil-A very ugly incident. Did any of you see any Facebook wars about that? Do you guys end up seeing like things in people's Facebook streams where the debates start happening about moral matters, or is that just people my age?
Howard Stern was very critical of it.
Yeah, well, and you'd expect him to be, wouldn't you? I mean, he's a committed liberal. He's in some ways very libertarian. He certainly doesn't like, you know, conservatives or traditional things. When people got into it, did they get particularly ugly? What did they say about the other side? I mean, there were a lot of funny jokes out there. Do you like the taste of hate in your chicken sandwich? I mean, you know, attributing that to somebody, now you're no longer doing rational argument. Now you're doing something quite different. Now you're trying to influence the other person to feel differently, right? You're trying to make them feel bad. Why do that? Why would somebody, instead of trying to make a rational argument, why would they just try to make somebody feel bad? Yeah.
Maybe because that person is like making me feel bad, but like, think that they're actually that their point of view is stupid, and that they start to not believe what they originally thought.
Okay, so there are a lot of different things. Let me sort of reconstruct that. So person A is making the other person feel bad. They're saying something to try to make them feel bad so that they'll abandon their position, they'll feel bad about holding their position, and then the argument's won by. Mm-hmm. That's it, yeah.
I think it has to deal with the feeling of like power, like you were saying, that like it's a really good feeling when you dominate someone in that argument. That's like, I don't know.
There's a flip side to it too. How many of you like being dominated? Anybody? How many of you like other people ordering you around and telling you how to feel? Do you kind of recoil against that? Is there kind of an emotional gut reaction against that?
People pay good money for it. I don't think anybody here does.
What's that? People pay, masochists, right? There are a class of people who like other people to dominate them and order them around. Yeah.
Back to the topic. I think part of it also is that if you minimize the argument and turn it into something more concrete, as opposed to moral right and moral right, but hate is wrong. We all agree that, you know, to hate anything would be wrong. Or some people would agree that just to say you hate this, or you hate goodness, is, you know, you can build an argument around that, you know, that they're a hate monger, so therefore, if you hate them...
That's an interesting one, because hate gets used in a very manipulative way by people in argument, too. All you have to do is accuse somebody else of hating.
Oh, well, that's what that comment is. You hate. Oh, therefore you must be wrong.
Yeah, and we throw that term around really easily these days. I mean, there could be a good argument there for like reserving the term hate for things where it's demonstrably hate, and not calling a whole bunch of other things hate because of the emotive effect of hate. That's a good sort of segue into talking about this emotive theory, right? So this emotive theory of meaning that MacIntyre is talking about, we saw a little bit with Sartre, is saying that the meaning of moral language or evaluative language is just expressing the viewpoint of the person saying it. And what viewpoint is it expressing? Their thoughts? No, it's expressing their feelings, their attitudes. So when I say something like, you're a good person, what I'm saying is, I approve of you. Or, what was your last name? Vera. I was going to say Vega, but I knew that wasn't right. Something like, yay, Mr. Vera, right? If that's the case, then all of our arguments, all of our moral positions are really just expressing our feelings.
They're subjective.
That's why we call it emotivism. Yeah, and emotivists say, well, you know, if you actually look at the way people are, that's all it boils down to. So this is a moral theory. This is a viewpoint that a lot of people do, in fact, hold. I think you could walk out on the street and find somebody who would actually say something along those lines if you listened, or go over to the cafeteria. Listen for a little while, especially, you know, people coming out of ethics class or, you know, political science class or whatever. Somebody's going to say something like that. Ah, they're only saying that because they feel that way. And they'll generalize and say, yeah, that's just the way people are. All this stuff about right and wrong, that's all BS. It's just ways we try to control each other, ways we try to manipulate each other. That's the emotivist theory. That's that viewpoint that MacIntyre's looking at. And one of the things, go ahead.
Wait, sorry, I have one thing. So if I hate something that is good, it doesn't mean I'm wrong, right?
Say that one more time. Let me.
If I hate something that is so-called good, it doesn't mean I'm wrong, right?
Well, if the thing was genuinely good, and you hated it, you'd be wrong to hate it.
How am I wrong? It's my own choice.
Oh, okay. So that's a good question. Putting things that way is emotivism. To say that all there is it's just my point of view. There's no other point of view by which we can evaluate these things. That's exactly what emotivism is saying. And if we have a natural tendency to do that, MacIntyre is saying, well, that's because our culture preaches that all the time. There are other points of view. You can actually say, it is meaningful to say, well, it's wrong to hate things that are actually good. Even if you do feel that way, your feelings could be wrong. Your feelings aren't automatically right just because they're your feelings. That would be a non-emotivist.
It wouldn't make me wrong, though.
Say again?
It doesn't make me right, but it doesn't make me wrong.
Oh, sure. I mean, if you hate something that's... Again, let's step outside of the emotivist perspective for a second. If there are things that are genuinely good, and you hate them, you are actually wrong to hate them.
All right, now let's not say like more than once, it's just one thing.
Just one good thing.
We're
not making this about you anyway.
No, I'm not about you. I'm talking about just an individual.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that he hates all good and makes him bad. Okay, yes, I could hear it in that. But
oh, okay. Just one good thing that
he does. I don't know. Not every
sure. But usually he loves good things, right? Well, then, insofar as that person loves good things, they're on the right track. They're right. Insofar as they hate these few things that they should love, they're wrong. So they're not perfect. They're right in some respects and wrong in other respects. Just like, for example, I can say about myself that when it comes to matters of justice, I'm a pretty good person. I play fair by people. I'm pretty squared away when it comes to that. When it comes to managing anger, I'm not a good person. I lose my temper far too easily, hold grudges, all those sorts of things. It's possible to say that a human being is good and bad, and just in different respects, right?
Wait, so then try to follow me on this. And then,
sure.
Right, so if I hate something that's good,
yeah.
It doesn't make me wrong, but not right. So if I'm good and I like something bad, like if I'm good now,
you're generally good, right?
I'm generally good, okay. Or whatever, but I hate something that's bad. Right?
Well, you should hate something that's bad.
I should not. I mean, I like something that's bad. Like,
oh, okay, yeah, yeah. Well, like me, like wrong. like being angry, right?
Right. Yeah. Be like whatever, but doesn't make you right. Does that consider you wrong then?
Yeah, wrong insofar as I you know, lose my temper and enjoy losing my temper. I'm wrong. Yeah.
That's not. All right.
No. It's not saying that I'm totally bad all across the board. I think that's where you're going with it, right?
Yeah.
right? It's not saying I'm a totally bad person, but I could certainly be a better person if I didn't lose my temper. Couldn't I?
All, what if it's just one of the aspects? I'm not talking about all. If I'm not.
Well, then it's just
all.
Like one little aspect, and then you're doing pretty good. Right?
Sure.
I mean, that's a good thing. These are really good questions, though. I mean, think about this. How many things do we actually have to work on in our lives? I know having a bad temper isn't the only thing about myself that I need to work on. It's not the only way in which I'm, if we abandon the emotivist perspective, it's not the only way in which I am not as good as I ought to be. You know, there's other things too, like being lazy once in a while, and, you know, eating too much. Yeah. Let me put something on the board too, will you?
I think it's an interesting question, but I think more importantly, I think it's one of those, you know, who am I kind of questions, and that kind of journey that people very rarely take on very early in life.
Yeah.
So you're asking, you know, so you ask the question, I hate something that is genuinely good, or that you like something that is genuinely bad.
Yeah.
In your frame of mind, coming from your place.
Yeah.
It's not a bad thing or a good thing. You just like it or dislike it.
Yeah.
So
if you like it, you think it's a good thing.
Right. So I mean, and it's one of those things where, for maybe somebody objective perspective,
yeah,
it might be something that they need to work on. But
yeah,
my subjective perspective doesn't feel that way. So you have this objective point
right.
of view and this subjective point of view. The subjective point of view is that this is okay.
Yeah,
I like smoking crack. Crack is good. I love crack, and I'm going to keep smoking crack until I die.
Yeah, every addiction winds up like that, right?
You know, it's
yeah.
a good thing. I
yeah.
don't see where the bad is. I feel good when I'm high.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But subject, you know, but objectively, as a person who might be working with people, that's a bad thing. Because
yeah.
Look what crack has done to your life.
And you can point towards criteria like that and say, hey, it's damaging to your relationships. Take a look at your lungs, you know. Here, let me give you an intelligence test and see how quickly you fill these things out compared to before.
Matter.
Right, and the reason why it doesn't matter is because they could actually look at those criteria and say, oh man, I better knock it off. But they say, well, I don't want to look at those criteria. And that's a subjective choice on their part.
And working with people, that you know, when you work with people,
yeah.
That leap between objective reality and subjective reality, that's where the work happens.
Yeah, and you know, to be fair, when it comes to moral matters, there's two points that I want to make about that. One is, when it comes to moral matters, they're by their nature pretty murky. So if you get those things wrong, you shouldn't feel terrible, because if you look throughout all of history, people are arguing about these things throughout all of history, because it's not that easy to figure out what's right and what's wrong in every case. The other thing is, if MacIntyre's right, we live in a culture that's kind of pushing this subjectivist, or what we're calling here, emotivist point of view, which says, hey, all there is how you feel about it. And if you don't, you know, if it doesn't jibe with you and your feelings, then, you know, that's it. I want to talk about this meaning and use thing. I want to go on from here. MacIntyre says that one of the mistakes that emotivism makes is mistaking the meaning of moral language for its uses. So the meaning of moral language would be, you know, what the expression is actually says, saying. So if you say stealing is wrong, that's not the same thing as the use that you might put to it, which is, you know, maybe making somebody feel bad who's been caught stealing. Like, think about when you were a kid. I'm sure all of you did something wrong, and your parents actually, without giving you any sort of explanation, just said, that's wrong, and they said it in a certain tone of voice that conveyed their anger or their irritation or their disgust or pick whatever, right? Is this an experience you went through? I went through it many times. Sometimes about, you know, things that were genuinely bad, looking back at it, and some things about, you know, very arbitrary. My mom had a thing about people spitting on the sidewalk. She went nuts, you know. Spitting on the sidewalk isn't nice, but if you spit on the sidewalk, you're not murdering anybody, you know, and you're not actually stealing anything. I guess it could be a public health issue, but it's not really that big of a deal. But she conveyed by talking about it, she gave the expression a certain use. And the use could be expressing personal preferences or emotions. You can make all sorts of uses out of things that you say. Just for one that actually conveys something about emotion, consider how many different uses you can make out of saying to somebody, I love you. Now, what's the meaning of I love you? You actually do love that person. You feel, can we define love? Maybe not here in this class right now. You know, we can teach a whole class about what is love, you know. But let's say that we actually have some sort of coherent idea. All of you have a good idea about what love looks like, what love means? I hope so. You've experienced it, both giving and taking. Okay, now, how do people use that expression? Think about the many different ways, yeah.
Like, I love Kate.
Yeah, let's just say that we're talking about a person. We'll come back to that, because that's a really important point, too, with respect to good and love and all these sorts of things. I love cake too. Look at it, right? My wife for my birthday made me a special cake that was chocolate and caramel and, you know, flan and, yeah. I can relate to liking cake. I like pies too, and tarts. Okay, so let's talk about I love you to a person. So you could actually be genuine with it, and you're expressing how you actually feel to that person, right? What are some other, go ahead.
I was going to say, like, use, like, I care about you.
Oh, yeah. Oh, now, is love and caring necessarily the same thing? This is where misunderstandings arise, isn't it? Sometimes, I love you. Sometimes we'll say, I love you, but I'm not in love with you. Mm-hmm. Right? And that could mean I care about you, but I'm really not romantically interested in you. I love you could be used to shut somebody up, couldn't it? Quit arguing with me, I love you. That would be a very different use, wouldn't it? Than expressing your care for another person. You might just want them to shut up. Maybe you don't actually love them. Maybe you just want them to knock it off. Any other uses of I love you that people could make that are not necessarily aligned with the more genuine use? Yeah.
If you're out on a Saturday night, girl, it's not necessarily.
Especially if you just met her,
it's
right?
It's kind of a short-term goal to get what you want. Maybe.
Yeah, and now it could mean something like I desire you, but that's not the same thing as love in a full sense. And so that's a use of a term. Now notice the last two ones that we looked at; those would be what MacIntyre would call manipulative uses of language, right? There's a difference between non-manipulative and manipulative uses of language. Emotivism, as he says, breaks down that distinction. Because if emotivism is correct, all we're doing when we say things like good, bad, you know, love, hate, any sort of emotionally, morally charged words, is expressing our emotions and trying to change the emotions of other people. Trying to change their behavior, too, based on those emotions. I mean, if you're out, you know, Saturday night, and somebody says, I think I'm falling in love with you, and what they really want is to get you in bed. They're not trying to just, you know, like, turn on a switch. They're actually trying to influence how you feel about things. They're saying, I love you, because they want certain feelings to happen on your part, which will result in, sooner or later, the two of you being in the same place at the same time, right? Outside of the bar. Did you say naked? Maybe. So I thought somebody else. Yeah, I mean that kind of goes with it, I think. Right? This is really basic stuff. This has to do with their everyday lives. So there's a lot of difference between meaning and use. And if emotivism is actually correct, all we have are these sort of manipulative uses. Now MacIntyre doesn't think that emotivism is actually correct. Why is he interested in talking about it? Just to, like, knock it down and now we're done with emotivism and we don't have to worry about it anymore? He's interested in it because he thinks that it's gotten its hooks into our culture. So the culture that we live in is thoroughly emotivist, and it's always pushing us. You heard me talk about this last time with Sartre, I think, a little bit, where I said, or maybe the first class, where I said, it's okay to judge. People are telling you all the time, don't be judgmental, right? It's okay to take a moral standpoint, but you have to try to back it up. You have to give some reasons. That's to try to appeal to impersonal criteria. If emotivism is correct, that's all BS, right? That's all just window dressing for us trying to push our preferences onto other people. Now, let's put aside the question of whether emotivism is or isn't correct. Are there people in our culture, have you experienced people who act that way and talk that way? As if all that's going on when we say good or bad, right, wrong, is just trying to control other people or express our feelings about things or get other people to see things our way. Sort of like to contaminate them with our emotions and get them to feel what we feel. Have you run into people like that? Yeah.
Like what comes to mind is the whole like abortion debate and the fact that like proponents and opponents are called like pro-life or pro-choice, because I feel like life and choice are things that people can agree are good things.
Yeah, and you notice both sides, they actually call each other the antis too, don't they?
Mm-hmm.
So if you're pro-life, you call the other side anti-life. And if you're pro-choice, you actually do call the other side anti-choice. I've been outside of abortion clinics and heard people, go ahead, that's this one. And heard people using that, and they don't even say like anti-choice, they just say those antis over there. If that's really the case, if they think, hey, you can't possibly reason with these people, they may well be emotivists. Are there any other people who are just like straight out emotivists? There might be certain professions or classes that lend itself to that. What about somebody who thinks that everything is just a matter of PR? That you can spin anything. There's no right, no wrong, just what works. Yeah.
I was gonna say, like, if you're a lawyer, you try to make everyone see things from a certain perspective.
Yeah, it's interesting. One of the books that's still read in a lot of law schools is Aristotle's Art of Rhetoric. You might say, well, why do they read a book that's 2,300 years old? Because it's got stuff in there that actually works if you want to make people feel certain things. And Aristotle says, what is rhetoric about? It's about, you know, rational persuasion, but it's also about making people feel certain emotions. And if you get people to feel certain emotions, Aristotle noticed this even back then. People don't see things the same way when they love or they hate, when they're angry, when they're not angry. So if you can manipulate people's emotions, and if that's all that there is, it's just emotions, preferences, desires, then you can achieve whatever ends you want. And there really can't be any debate about whether those are good or bad ends. Because any debate would just be a matter of me pushing my views onto you. My views that I hold, why? Just because I feel that way. Why do you hold your views? Well, you just feel that way. What about other cases where people are sort of manipulating other people? Yeah.
Could it be like extreme religious cases, like Hasidic Jewish people, or
would
that be just like an organization?
Usually, when you've got something like that, where there's a robust religious tradition, that'll be something different than what MacIntyre is calling emotivism. He's contrasting the emotivist self, which is really, you know, it could be anything. There's no thing that it's particularly tied to. If you're a Hasidic Jew, you're living a particular lifestyle that imposes a lot of demands on you, way more than most things in contemporary society. And when you argue with people, you might argue like an emotivist. You might say, hey, I just like being a Hasidic Jew. You like being this, you know, that's the only reason why I'm doing it. But I don't know too many religious people who have those sort of commitments who actually say things like, I just like being religious and that's all there is to it. It's just my feelings. What about when people are trying to manipulate other people? Get what they want.
Yeah.
Like salesmen?
Yeah, I mean, there are some salesmen who I would not walk down a dark alley with if I had, you know, a pocket full of money, because there isn't any, you know, moral restraint that's going to keep them from rolling me. Not just salespeople, by the way. I don't want to just pick on salespeople. There's plenty of other people who walk down a dark alley with. On the other hand, there's plenty of guys that I taught when I was working in the prison who I'd have no trouble trusting my family with, because I know they have some sort of moral standards that they're living by. Even within a prison, even some of them will never get out because they did such horrible things at one time. The real thing is whether you think everything boils down to these subjective preferences or not. Let's look at this description that MacIntyre has of the emotivist self. And this is in chapter 3. So he says, the emotivist self ends up not having any sort of moorings. I'm going to read you a passage. He says, of the self as presented by emotivism, we have to note this. It cannot be simply or unconditionally identified with any particular moral attitude or point of view, just because of the fact that its judgments are, in the end, criterionless. If you ask an emotivist, why do you see things that way? Their only answer can be, that's just the way I feel. And they will project that onto everybody else. Why does Aristotle see things the way he does? He just feels that way. He doesn't really have any reason for it. So you don't really need to read Aristotle, because, you know, once you've actually got the bullet points and you know what he's actually saying, if you don't feel that way, why bother? Same thing with Kant or anybody else. This is a kind of lonely way to be, unless you can find everybody else to feel the same way as you. He says that specifically modern self finds no limits set to that on which it may pass judgment. So along with this goes being able to judge anything that you like, because all the judgments really just boil down to matters of preference, right? Let's think about, you know, one of these issues. Why shouldn't I be obese? Maybe I should just eat all the time. I know I like eating. I like eating a lot more than I like exercising. You know? What could you point out to me that would you know, show me that I'm wrong? Yeah.
Bad overall health.
Yeah, maybe I like being in bad overall health. Maybe I enjoy that. It sounds silly, right? But why does it sound silly to you? Because, you know, when I was your age, I was in phenomenal shape. I was, you know, right out of the army. I was working out 3 hours a day, every day, doing endurance lifting and, you know, all sorts of martial arts things and rucksack, you know, with 75 pounds in it and all that. Well, I liked doing that at the time. After a while, I quit liking doing that. I remember what it was like to feel in that super good health, you know. I can understand what that's like. But maybe that's no longer a value for me. If it's not a value for me, then really there's nothing you can do, right? Sort of like the person who's addicted to crack, the more extreme example. They really like crack. Crack is, you know, the reason why crack is addicting is because it is, you know, for those who smoke it, very enjoyable. It's got some bad side effects. Yeah, so does eating too much and not exercising. Like you're pointing out, bad health. See, here's the thing. If we are emotivists, then there's no traction. There's no sort of anchor points for using any sort of rational criteria, any sort of impersonal criteria. Let's say you actually wanted to make me, you know, start exercising more and curb my eating and not, you know, have, you know, snacks before I go to bed and things like that. You know, how would you make me do it if you were an emotivist? You're not going to argue me into it. What do you do? Yeah.
Show you like what could happen if you continue to do it. Mm-hmm. In future years.
Maybe you appeal to my fears. Yeah. What you needed to show me then is like, you know, some really gross stuff, right? Not some facts and figures. What else might you do?
Well, I think that appeal to your emotions and appeal to making you feel less than because you're that way.
Shame. Yeah, shame is an emotion that we can use. Yeah?
Not fear or shame, but more like positive, like, influence towards it. You know, like, so like...
Yeah, I could be part of the group, right? Yeah. There could be... You find other hooks. Now notice that none of these hooks are sort of rational. They're all not necessarily totally irrational, but they're non-rational. They appeal to our emotions. And if you appeal to my emotions, are you appealing to her emotions? No, you got to make a separate appeal to her emotions. She's got a very different standpoint than I do, I imagine. And look around most of the people in the room. Nobody's old like I am. Well, you're older, but not as old as I am. So you have to find different ways to hook this in. But it ultimately turns out just to be these, you know, one-on-one appeals to emotions. MacIntyre thinks that our culture is become very emotivist. And I think you can see a lot of signs of this. The way moral disagreement tends to break down is one way. What he's going to identify as characters in our society is another way. And one of the things that he says about emotivism from a social perspective is that it destroys the distinction between manipulative and non-manipulative types of social relations or ways of interacting with other people. So it turns everybody not necessarily into a manipulator all the time, but somebody who can't see any real difference between not manipulating people, treating them as if they have something like inherent dignity or worth, and manipulating people, seeing them as just means to an end, a tool, something like that. Sometimes even seeing themselves that way. So if emotivism gets into a culture, and MacIntyre thinks that it has with ours, that's one of the things that happens. What he's calling characters are certain social roles. And so let's talk for a minute just about social roles. We have all sorts of different social roles. And what do we mean by that? I'm occupying one social role right now just in talking to you up here in front of the stage, you know, is about some stuff that I put in iLearn for you, that I went to school and got a PhD in. Well, I didn't get a PhD in MacIntyre, but you know, you get the idea, right? You guys are occupying a social role by your behavior here right now. Is this the only social role that you have, the only social role that I have? I'm a father, I'm a husband, a son. Those are familial roles, but those are also social roles, right? If I don't send my kids anything on their birthday, am I a good dad or bad dad? Some people are only whispering it. Go ahead and say it. Bad dad, right. Wait, what are we talking about here? Not sending the kids anything on their birthday? Yeah, that'd be bad. I mean, there's other things that go into being a good dad besides that. But there's a social role, and we can say people are fulfilling their social roles well or not. And do you have a lot of social roles? Any of you have a job? There's a social role, right? If you're a waiter, I don't have any. What job do you guys have? Let's say you're a waiter, you're coming to the table, there's certain expectations of you, there's certain expectations you have of the other people. These govern our interactions. They make things intelligible, MacIntyre says. And you don't actually have to buy into your social role, necessarily. You could be just like putting it on, or being kind of, you could have doubts about it. He uses the example, for example, of a Catholic priest or a union leader who, they say the things that they're supposed to say, but they don't really believe it. You know, the Catholic priest has lost his faith, or the union leader really hates working people and would like to sell them out if he could, but he doesn't. So there's certain social roles where our personality could be different than the role that we have. You know, I don't feel like being a professor all the time. It's not a bad role to have, but you know, it's not the only thing I want to do, right? There are certain social roles, MacIntyre says, that tie personality, or there's certain social roles where personality is tied in with it. Where if you're having this kind of social role, there's really a lot of pressure to conform yourself to it, to have a certain kind of moral expectation, to value things in a certain way. And he talks about three, maybe there could be more in modern culture. that fit into this emotivist thing. He talks about another one in another place.
And he calls these the aesthete, the manager, and the therapist. Now, that doesn't mean that every time that you get involved with management, you're necessarily the manager. And that doesn't mean that if you go and see a therapist, they're a bad person, they're an emotivist. Right? That's not necessarily so, right? But there is something about these particular roles in modernity, MacIntyre thinks, that tie in with emotivism. But let's talk about this for a second, though, aesthete. You ever called anybody an aesthete? Oh, you're such an aesthete. You almost have to be one to use that term. What do you think this means? Yeah.
Is that the consumer
one? Yeah, I put that it's essentially being like
rich,
a consumer.
Something rich, right?
Yeah, he is the rich aesthete, but you don't actually have to be rich in our society to fit the bill for that. It helps to be rich, because that takes your mind off of a lot of things. What does it mean to be an aesthete? Yeah.
Kind of like materialistic almost.
Well,
like face value.
Not necessarily. I mean, there are certain ways in which you could do it where you might be very materialistic. What other word can you think of that has some sort of connection with that?
Aesthetic.
Aesthetics, yeah. What is aesthetics? Yeah.
Beauty.
Has to do with beauty. It is a philosophical discipline. It's like, concerned with what is beauty, what is art, what is the sublime. Now, think about the kind of valuation that goes into assessing something as beautiful. Or let's use some other aesthetic categories that we actually use in our own time. Something is cool. That's an aesthetic category. Something is stupid. When you contrast cool and stupid, you're not actually saying something lacks intelligence. If you call an album stupid, you're not actually saying that the album is stupid, right? You're saying it's aesthetically unpleasing in some way, aren't you? It lacks certain aesthetic characteristics. What are the sort of things that you might say this about? Works of art, right? How many of you go to the museum, look at works of art every single week? Get your art books open and, Matisse. Is that your aesthetic experience that you're making judgments about most of the time? Yeah.
Like scenery is like a nice view.
Okay, that's an important one. Marist is nice because it's gotten quite a few. I remember the last place that I worked, I didn't realize how ugly it was until I had a friend come and I wanted to give this friend a tour and I thought, where would be a nice place on campus to take them? And I realized there wasn't any. Not a single nice view. Yeah. So it was aesthetically unpleasing.
Like advertisement posters or, just...
Yes.
Medium.
Yes. All those glossy magazines that are filled with ads. People actually put those ads together and they got paid a good amount of money to put those ads together in aesthetically pleasing ways. And therefore, products that may or may not be aesthetically pleasing. Hopefully, when you put the product on, if it's, say, clothes or something like that, it actually looks good. If it's cologne or perfume, hopefully it actually smells good. It smells different in the magazine than it's going to smell on your body, right? All of you know that. What else do we get all aesthetic about? If we want to, use that sort of term. Bless you. Attractiveness of people. What about food? Mm-hmm. Food is very much about aesthetics. Now, can you look at the whole world in terms of just everything being an aesthetic phenomenon, everything being there just for enjoyment, for consumption, for maybe talking about or tweeting about or Facebooking about? Now we have Pinterest, right? Pinterest is an aesthetic social media by its very nature. Are there people who live their whole lives and sort of submerge moral judgment into just aesthetic judgment? That would be the rich aesthete. They worry more about whether something is cool than whether it's good. As a matter of fact, they don't even worry about whether it's good or bad. Those are not categories, after a while, that make sense to them. And if emotivism is right, why wouldn't that make sense? If good and bad is just how we feel about stuff, how is that any different than I like cake, you like pie, I like, you know, shrimp scampi, and you like some other shrimp dish, you know? It's all, you know, I like this music, you like that music. That is a type that, as MacIntyre says, fits into this emotivist ethos. Let's look at the other two. They're even more interesting. The manager. What's going on in bureaucratic organizations, in groups, where you have to allocate resources? Doesn't every company have a mission statement? Marist actually has a mission statement. How many of you looked at the mission statement? A good portion of you. Is it particularly meaningful? It is? That's an unusual mission statement, then, isn't it?
It's like in, like, sentence. So it's like, it outlines what it expects of, like, the students, like,
yeah.
Like being open-minded, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, these are values that are supposed to be inculcated, you know, come in. If you're closed-minded, we're going to fix that by the end, right? A lot of mission statements nobody pays much attention to, though. Why? I mean, isn't it pretty important? I mean, that's the whole goal that we're after, yeah.
For the most part, companies have sort of the same mission statement, I guess.
Yeah, to deliver a quality product to the consumer at, you know, a good price. That could apply to so many different ones. And those are values, right? But those are primarily values of efficiency. There are companies who say they want to change the world, you know, fix things. But, you know, you could be involved in one of those organizations and not care about that at all. You could be, like, so concerned with, okay, what are my goals? How am I going to accomplish them? What are my resources? How am I going to, as MacIntyre says, how am I going to connect means to these ends? And you never think about the ends. You know, I mean, it's interesting, and I'm not actually knocking war or fighting or things like that myself right now, but there are a lot of people who worked at companies till we outsourced a lot of this stuff that produced munitions or bombers or missiles or things like that, and it didn't matter to them at all that what they were producing were instruments of death. And they might have actually been, you know, people who personally, they felt that war is a bad thing. Or, you know, American wars are bad. Or, you know, the current regime's war, or whatever. But they don't focus on that. Because what their job is to do is to make everything run properly. And so questions of right and wrong can't really be dealt with, because those are a matter of individual values. Those are subjective. So we have to push those out of the process. What can you focus on? Efficiency. Doing the most with the resources that you have. That becomes the primary goal. And that's the only part where they're being rational. Everything else is just emotivist. For the therapist, MacIntyre says what the manager does in the life of organizations, the therapist does with respect to health and, you know, personal well-adjustment, those sorts of things, getting us over, he uses an old category that we don't use in psychology anymore, our neuroses. Now we talk in terms of disorders, you know, since DSM-4 or 3. There's some EdSite people in here, right? You should know that. 4, we changed to disorders, I think, from neurosis. Sounds about right. We'll just say for the yeah. The therapist, like MacIntyre says, is not primarily concerned with truth. They're concerned with making people feel better, happier, you know, fit in better with other people. That's the primary goal. And you can do that while thinking that value judgments are all just purely subjective, just, you know, expressions of our emotions or preferences. That would actually make you a pretty good therapist, wouldn't it? You wouldn't be bothered by all these sort of worries about whether you're actually steering people in the wrong way. So long as you can figure out how to get rid of their disorders and make them fit in better according to certain, you know, expert criteria that you can find in the DSM, the Diagnostic Statistical Manual, right? That's a mouthful. You're doing the right thing. So with the manager and the therapist, worries about ultimate ends and whether they're actually good ends or not, get rid of those. Just focus on the process. With the rich aesthete, you don't even have that. You just have, I'm just going to focus on whatever makes me feel good. These are all types of emotivist characters. These are ways in which people, you might say, structure their lives and their activities. And these define the ways in which we interact with each other in our culture quite a bit. Like we said with the drug addict, if you're a drug addict and you get into a treatment program and you want to get better, they don't care why you want to get better. They're just interested in getting you better by certain criteria. They don't care whether that affects all these other things, do they? So long as they can produce you eventually as somebody who's cured, that's fine. And notice, too, that the same things could be tied in with, say, the same organization. Some people adopt social causes almost like rich aesthetes. They just want to get involved with something that makes them feel kind of good, and like they're contributing something and making a difference. But they never actually worry about whether it's really good or bad, the cause that they're tied in with. They just want to have something to be tied in with. That would be this. At the same time, who makes the cause actually work? You could have some manager who, you know, is not interested in that cause whatsoever. They're just interested in making those dollars that are contributed actually funnel to the right things. Whatever it is that they're trying to distribute, make it happen. If you want to be an emotivist, we all inhabit certain social roles. What does MacIntyre mean by that? I'm inhabiting one right now by being up in front of the blackboard and talking to you and doing this lecturing, and you're inhabiting one by sitting back in the chairs and taking notes and, you know, thinking about how, you know, what this might have to do with the readings and all of that. What's the roles? Student, professor, right? If I go and do this in the park, they might lock me up. Or, you know, somebody might come by and say, what are you doing? Right? Imagine, you know, no chalkboard, just gesturing in the air and stuff like that. If you're doing this, say, in a bar, people look at you kind of weird, wouldn't they? There's a different social role involved. Bartender is a social role, isn't it? Mechanic is a social role. Parents, children, these are social roles. You know, there's certain expectations that come with them, certain ways that people want to behave. Doctor, patient, these are social roles. Are you your social roles? Are you just these involvements that you have with other people? The emotivist really has nothing other than those social roles. And he points out two guys. You're talking about Sartre, and he talks about this Goffman guy. Goffman is a psychologist, and he's looking at how people take on these roles, almost like masks that they're putting on and putting off. Now, you take all the masks away, what's left? According to Goffman, nothing. Same thing with Sartre. Why is there nothing left? Because there couldn't be anything left. Just raw preferences and emotions, and those things are going to change, right, from moment to moment. So with the emotivist, there's really nothing other than these social roles that you can count on and depend on to stay the same. If you want them to stay the same, you have to continually try to influence them, continually use moral language to try to make them feel a certain way and continue to feel that way. Think about the abortion thing, right? How much whipping up of emotion there has to be on both sides to get them to stand out there, you know, escorting people in or holding up picket signs. Many of those people might be there from principle, but many of them may just be emotivists. He also talks about, and this is another important thing, he says, the emotivist self can have no rational history. This is something we're going to look at next class session. Each one of you has a history. And I don't just mean like, you know, your documents that you carry around with you, like your grades or transcripts or stuff like that, or your medical history. Each one of you has a moral history. Each one of you has made some changes, has improved or declined in certain ways. And these could be up for debate. You know, there are some problems with saying good in what respect and all that. Or from what perspective, right? So I am conscious of the problem that you brought up before. But each one of you has some sort of idea of where you've been and where you're going and what kind of person you want to be and whether you're measuring up to that. If you're a thoroughgoing emotivist, you can't actually make that rational. It's just a bunch of stuff that's happened. And why did you change your mind about things? Why do you, you know, no longer do the things that you do that you recognize were bad, maybe bad for you or bad for other people? No reason, you just feel differently about it. You don't have any reasons for it if you're an emotivist. If you're not an emotivist, then you can say, yeah, I actually recognize this is the wrong thing to do. I'll give you an example from my life. So I've mentioned that I do have not particularly good temper. I used to argue with people, and I used to be really ruthless in arguing. And I was sort of a good example of this meaning-use thing. The stuff that I was saying was completely true. I was really smart in grad school, and I could read, you know, other languages pretty easily, learn them, and you know, go to the original texts, and so I could, you know, usually in argument beat other people on their own grounds, on the grounds that we were picking, if they were other grad students or sometimes even other professors. And I was a real jerk. I alienated quite a few people. I drove another kid from actually coming to grad school. He was coming to visit, and I got into a big argument with him about, you know, Sartre and Marxism and stuff like that, and just crushed the guy, you know. It was so bad that people started, you know, avoiding getting into arguments with me, which wasn't good either, because then I would, you know, sort of, well, here's what, you know, what's being said, and sometimes I was wrong. It would have been nice for somebody to actually come out and say, no, you're wrong about that. That's changed, thank God, right? I don't sort of try to demolish opponents in arguments anymore. Why did that change? Now, if I was just an emotivist, there's no explanation for it. I just feel differently about it. I didn't like other people, you know, looking at me like a jerk. That could be it. Is that a real reason for changing anything? Not really. Maybe some other people in the same situation just didn't care about what other people thought. They're going to keep doing the same thing. What else could motivate me to change that? Let's say you were that way. Maybe a few of you are. Yeah.
I think that maybe you sort of come to a realization of what's the purpose of arguing, why argue?
Yeah, that's a good one. That there is some purpose beyond just winning or demonstrating your knowledge or dominating other people. I also started to realize how much I was hurting other people by doing that. How much I was suppressing their own sort of activity as students in learning and trying things out. Then I felt bad. But I wasn't just feeling bad because people were saying, hey, you're doing the wrong thing, you're a jerk. I was feeling bad because I recognized objective harm that was coming to other people as a result of it. And so I changed that. That's part of my history. So at least in that respect, I'm not saying I'm a completely good person or anything. At least in that respect, I went from being a bad person in that respect to a better person. And you can chart out why that happened. There's a rational set of choices that got made, choices that you could make if you were in a similar situation. If I was mentoring you and I saw that you had those sort of tendencies, I might tell you that story and I might bring up the reasons why I changed. Why? Not just to make you feel bad, but to actually say, here's some reasons why you ought to go this way. If somebody's an emotivist, that's not accessible for them. And they think that that's not accessible for anybody else. So like he says, inner conflicts are just the confrontation of one contingent arbitrariness by another. So when you're conflicted about something, if you're an emotivist, you got no way to resolve it. If you get into arguments with other people, you're just trying to sort of reduce everything to everybody's feelings, or their opinions, as we often put it. I'll leave you with this. Does our culture push that kind of view onto us? Think about a lot of television shows, particularly reality shows. When people get into conflict with each other, think about Housemates, right? On these ones where they cram a bunch of people who they know are not going to get along with each other. Why? Because they have different values, different viewpoints, different feelings. How many of them do you think are emotivists? Think about that next time you're watching one of those shows, if you watch that kind of stuff. This is a real issue. MacIntyre is bringing this up so we can get a good handle on it and try to get past it. And that's where we'll leave off for today.